guys. Welcome back to Wind Chaser. We have Kitty on tillage. And soon we will have our AT T9-450. Have it set up, adjusted the follow me, so it wasn't so expensive to run. So right now we're running about 175 an hour. I'm gonna do about 8.5 meter offset, so we're gonna bump this up to 8.5. So that's all set up. Then we're gonna run this guy. Gonna have him drop that. See how it goes. So, shouldn't be losing that much money. Probably help if we were had our GPS line on. So it should be about $2 a minute is what it should cost us to run these two machines together for the hired workers. So a little bit more done per hour. Because obviously course play doesn't really work on with multiplayer, so this is the next best alternative. Never really used it before because it would charge, it's set at default at 2,000 an hour. So I just went ahead and changed that to about 175, and then 100 if you're playing on easy. So it's a little bit more manageable. Especially when you're trying to cover the acres that we're doing. If you're the only one on the server at the time, it helps out. Only downside to follow me mod, if you get a little too far ahead, it kind of starts to lose its place. Oh, looks like there's a little bit of residue there. It's a little bit tricky sometimes to take these turns and whatnot. I want to make sure that we're actually covering what we need to cover, not leaving anything. And it seems to be good. Nice thing about this Challenger is the big wide open window here can really get a good view of your implement in the back and get a nice nice view in front of you on the side. So really like just the visibility in this cab and compared to you know, those articulating tractors, those big articulating tractors, you don't have as greater visibility of what you're actually doing in the game here. So kind of like these single units, single non-articulating tractors a little bit better. I like running like an 8R on the planter too. It's just a little bit easier. Or the MTRRTs on the big DB120. Just a little bit easier to control your implement and easier to see what you're doing. Now when you're taking inside lanes like this turn that we're gonna have coming up, usually you want to keep it nice and tight because your follow me driver is on the outside. So try to keep it as tight as I can, slow down a little bit, and then drop my implement back on the ground. The only downside about follow me is they don't pick up their implement, you know, so he's gonna take his turn. Don't really have to worry about him going outside the headland because I think Mike did two passes on the headland, so that's four implements wide. Otherwise, farm's looking mighty nice right now. A lot of trees going on. New house, new shed, new auger there. It's kind of a nice little private area and what otherwise would be pretty much just open fields. We all like our privacy around here. And then the farm up on the hill is pretty secluded as well. See all of our fields. We finished cultivating 27, 28, 26, 25. That's all finished. And then still have 13, 14. I think 20, I don't know, that might be 23. And then our 44 north still have to do. So there's quite a bit more, quite a bit of acreage we need to do. But I don't know, I'd say maybe 10 more hours of tillage should be all done. And then we can start turning our sights to planting, which everyone really enjoys planting because that means the hard part's pretty much over. Once you get the seed in the ground, it's pretty easy to maintain with the sprayers. Oh shit, someone else is coming on. You know what I should do is rent a additional 2720, and so we can get three of these tractors going just to get things done. Pretty sure this is Jake that's coming on. He's probably gonna want to run the kitty, which is fine. Gotta love when people are syncing up. Takes forever sometimes. TeamSpeak because I think whoever is on is on connections. Connect.
Connected.
Oh, it's Mike. So we'll go over to the shop here, go over to Plows, rent this for a day. So he's going to be running down there to the shop. So this isn't quite. So that should be a little bit better. We're missing a little bit. So I just reduced mine a little bit. We're right at our maximum working with at 8.5. So dropped it down to 8.4. We're going pretty ham on the tillage right now. We're gonna have 3 2720s in the field, so have this kitty's rented, rented the additional 2720. We're gonna be trading in all of our equipment at 100 hours and in some of this ATI that about 75 hours on it. he's gonna be over there by one. We're doing two. Okay, three is finished. There's 10 west. In cab a little bit. So I wonder what kind of acreage we're covering doing our deep tillage. We're at 18.5 hours on this tractor. No great demands going on yet. Hopefully he's going in the right spot. That would mark that done. I think a 13 shank 875 would look awfully nice behind this, as would a 2730. The nice thing about a 2730 is I have a lot of the components already built, as does Raphael for his 13 shank. But that 13 shank, it's quite a bit different than the 9 shank frame. After you look at it, it's a lot of additional modeling you'd have to do to that. The 2730, it uses what seems to be components from a Ecolo Tiger, and it also basically what I've done is I redid my shanks that I have on this one. I actually redid them a little bit, made them a little bit nicer, and then obviously I'm going to be using my discs for my 2623, and I'm going to be using a lot of the framing for my 2623 and the wheels and the lowering mechanisms, so it'll definitely be a really sweet machine. Because 27's great, but at this point it's an incredibly old model for actually my first model I built from scratch. So since then I've improved pretty dramatically. It's a great model, but it definitely needs to be redone to match the quality of texturing and modeling of the 2623. And, you know, it's just the, you know, they came out, Deere came out to 2730, so it's a little bit more heavy duty primary tillage. And I'm sure one day Decker will figure out a way to incorporate compaction into soil management and maybe create a new kind of cultivator tool like you did the manual weeder mechanism, and maybe instead of being a plower or cultivator, it'll be like a chisel plower, deep tillage or vertical tillage or ripper, some kind of cutter area like that. So it'll be it will still be a plow with the plow texture, but it'll be one more thing, one more additional specialization in the mod description that will soil mod will recognize as a deep vertical tillage kind of thing. So I don't know. I think this game really needs the ability to differentiate between like a disc plow texture and a chisel plow kind of plow texture. So like a disc will give you maybe a plow texture, but it will do nothing to eliminate your compaction that's built up over plowing and harvest and stuff like that. I don't know. I think that'd be a really cool feature. And it's just one more thing to kind of focus on. So yeah, we burnt up what, like $6 now, if that. Spike's over there doing some work on north part of 11, which is great. Putting some hours on our other T9. So I'm going about 9 miles an hour, 9.2. About a mile an hour faster than my course play. Which is great. Reason why you buy these big machines is for efficiency, trying to cover as many acres per hour as you can. T9 450 is just a tad bit underpowered for that kind of implement, but it's really at the minimum horsepower requirement, I believe, for this 2720. I wish I had these mods back in 13 with more realistic. That would be great. You know, but what can you do? So, we're going pretty heavy in canola, actually. I almost kind of want to do something else, really. I mean, we're doing corn, beans, and canola. Obviously alfalfa. Alfalfa is our money maker. Tremendous profit on that crop, even after I reduced the yield and prices. So. just yields a little bit better than grass. But I'm not even sure if grass actually works with soil mods. So unless it's on plowed texture, plowed or field terrain. So I remember when I first started playing this map in 13. Initially, it was a Benz Nord map that has since been completely gutted and redone. But I left some of the original map outline, like field outlines, and this is one of them, I believe. I believe this is original. And I can't remember. But I remember when I first started farming this field, I thought it was so big. And now, after I've literally farmed this field for maybe, this is probably like the 10th or 12th time I've plowed this field over the years that I've played this game. So after you've logged that many hours plowing this field and other fields like it, it's just, you know, you're just like, okay, well, this is going to take me an hour and a half to do, or an hour, and you just do it and you don't really think about it anymore. And you're just so used to doing it that after a while it just doesn't seem that big, but it really makes you appreciate the smaller fields, and you just hammer them out in a matter of, you know, 20 minutes and you just get some pwned. So and then even planting this field with the big DB120, it still takes quite a bit of time, even with 120 foot working width. But I definitely think we're going to go with two DB60 corn planters for our beans and corn, and try to bust out a lot of that with two tractors. Should be interesting. We're probably going to run our T9s on the planters, just because I think the guys want to get the hours on those things so we can trade them in for some bigger machines. But we definitely need to get some great demands on our crops. Also, finally went ahead and I converted the pup trailers for the Wilsons. Got around to doing that. It's about 600 bushel on the pup trailer heaped, and it's about 1200 bushel on the Wilson, the tandem heaped. So we can cart away quite a bit of bushels, about 1850 bushels if everything's heaped. Did that so it's all washable and stuff. Had the original blender file saved, so it was pretty easy to go ahead and separate all the separate UV meshes that were joined together on the objects. So now washable. Redid the fill planes too, so the fill planes don't flicker anymore. Those fill planes are about a year old, so went ahead and redid that. I didn't get too fancy with it, just kind of made it a little simple. So. Works the way it should. Slowly over the versions of edits that I did on this map, some major, some not so major edits, really fixed the terrain, so the terrain's a little bit more entertaining, a little bit more character to the terrain. Like this used to be pretty relatively flat. Now it's got, you know, slight difference in elevation throughout the whole thing, which is really great. You go over here, you can just see all the differences, makes all the implements work, and takes a long time to make everything nice and smooth as well. But square flat fields, basically it's, I think square flat fields about the dumbest thing in the game as you can get. I mean, take note from like European maps. I mean, all the detail and character they put into those European maps, those Italian maps, it's really great. Spiraling roads that go up and down in elevation and stuff like that. So try to kind of emulate that in this map with, you know, it's a big 4x map, but I wanted that same amount of detail. But I mean, it's, you know, Midwest style, so it's not compact, but it's detailed and it's great. So. So I have passenger mod in some of these, like the combines, but it never seems to work. Like if someone else is in it, I can't like tab over and get into that passenger. So I'm not really sure how that script actually works, because as far as I know, it's scripted correctly. It's all in the mod description, it's in the XML, it's in the i3D, and you go in game and it doesn't really, there's no difference. So curious if anyone's ever been able to tab into a vehicle on multiplayer with a passenger script, because I have yet to do that. Kind of torn between a 9RT and a Kitty. I think running two Kitties would be good. But I also think running two 9RTs would also be good. But since everyone has the John Deere now, I think we'll probably go with Kitty just to be a little bit different. Pick up a 775E for a rolling tractor and a planting tractor. We could save our big kitties for tillage and grain cart duty. Maybe even DN duty, but who knows. It's always a good sign when you reach this part of the field. Working your way down to some shorter passes. I think we're a little far ahead of our worker, so. Wonder what Mike's up to. Looks like Mike's. So curious what our finances are right now. Vehicle running costs, wage payment, 12.8. But should be about $2 a minute with this guy. So we have an hour left on our rental. Definitely going to be spending money in overcharges, because I think we all decided to go with the Kitty on tillage. Just get it done. But the overcharge fee on this is pretty hefty, I think. $11,000 to rent this kitty for one day, so. But, I mean, the amount of work we get done at with that $11,000, it really, I mean, it depends on what your priorities are. If you want to get it done as quick as possible, do you want to, you know, if you were to rent this tractor, it saves us, you know, hours on our other tractor, because if we get to 100 hours, that means we have to probably drop another 150 grand just to upgrade that tractor after trade-in. So, you know, 11,000 whatever. You know, even if you were to rent it for probably, you know, 3, 4 days for all your tillage. You know, 40, you know, 33, 44,000 is a lot cheaper than dropping a 150 grand on a new tractor after trade-in, so. Might seem like a lot of money, but as soon as you get it to 100 hours on your other machines, it gets really expensive to trade those in. So we're doing a lot better on tillage now than our last season because we have our 2720s instead of the little 9 shank, and we rented that large 50-foot disc instead of the 30-foot Tiger Mate cultivator. So we're covering, probably 50% or more ground, 50 to 100% more ground per hour than we were previously. So. Makes the job go pretty quick, and I think everyone was pretty excited to run that 2623 disc. It's actually really fun to use, actually. Cover some serious ground. I think the calculation was like 56 or 58 acres per hour. I really have no idea how many acres we cover per hour on this. I would imagine it's probably like 20, if that. So maybe 15. Well, this field is probably, let me see here, we're in field 2. It's about 40 hectares, which is about a 100-acre field. And this 100-acre field takes probably an hour with two of these things, so I. No, it probably takes about 2 hours. I don't remember. I'd imagine it's probably close to 2 or 3 hours. I don't know, I guess I'd figure out how long I've been recording and then figure it out from there. But I mean, it took me like damn near an hour to plant this thing with the DB. I don't know, but the field is roughly 100 acres. We probably spend 2 hours of tillage on this, so we're looking at probably 25 acres per hour would be my guesstimate. Or I guess you can do the math and figure, you know, ideal conditions, we're probably going around 10 miles an hour. Averaging 10 miles an hour, working with is 8.5, so you could probably figure in what your maximum actual acres per hour are, but you know, in real life, this thing would be pulling this at probably 5.5, not 10. So, but we're a little bit faster than a lot of things. Like we have our planter at 9 miles an hour, which you'd probably be planting at 5.5. Well, except they have those new high-speed planters, which you could plant at like 9, I think. Like, which is kind of like hauling ass across the field. Real life, this would probably be 5, 5.5. That disc, you could probably pull that disc at probably 10 or 12. I know those big horse Porsche Jokers, they pull those at 12 mile an hour, but you're probably looking at probably another six to eight on that disc, depending on how big of a disc you're running. The disc on that 23 is spec'd at 24 inches in diameter, so they're 24 inches in diameter, so pretty big discs. These discs on this machine, I have no idea. I just built them. I didn't actually build them to scale, so I don't know what the scale of the disc are. But I know the discs that I built for that 2623, basically everything on that model is scaled correctly. Frame, channeling, everything is to scale. I think they're a little bit bigger than these, so I think these are a little bit smaller at 24 inches, because the ones on the 2623 are, I think, are quite probably like 20% bigger than these. That's one of the things is when you're initially building a model for the first time in Blender and you have nothing to reference it off of, it becomes really difficult to build things. I don't really worry about scale. I worry about getting everything proportionally correct, like the length and the width and the height. Because if everything is built to proportion to one another, then you can worry about scaling after, scaling up, scaling down, once the whole thing is built. Because if it's built proportion to, you know, everything is built in proportion to one another, then it's, you know, scaling isn't really an issue. You can scale it. Using GE, you can figure out, okay, I need to get at 8.5 meters and then scale the whole thing there, and then re-export out of Blender after you scale the whole thing. So that's not a big issue, but building everything to proportion to one another, it's pretty challenging unless you can find some nice profile aerial view pictures to overlay or superimpose on your build, so you can space out your framings and stuff like that, and align your shanks where they should be, and get the correct angle on your disc, which I figure out that, I mean, the angle on these discs is right around 22 to 23 degrees. Seems to be pretty much what I've figured out for the angulation of these discs. I never really found any kind of spec data which shows you the actual angulation of the disc. And some of these things, you can actually change the angle on the disc for a more aggressive or less aggressive kind of cut. So, like the Krauss Dominators and like stuff like Kuhn Krauss. Now, a lot of those things, you can kind of adjust the to get a more acute or obtuse angle of the discs. And then depth control, you can sink them a little bit deeper, pull them up a little bit lighter. I'm not sure how they adjust the actual shanks. So we probably did about half of this field already. Tilling in all of our nutrients we broadcasted, so try to get as much bang for a buck at getting as much nutrients in the ground as we possibly can, getting a nice neutral pH, because 4 weeks from after we plant, things are going to start to go down and go down pretty quick. I think our biggest struggle this season is going to be trying to maintain the moisture in these fields because the rains and the forecast really aren't on our side this week. So, but at the same time, it's not that hot either. I mean, there's only one or two days over 22, so. Profile of these cat tractors is pretty cool too. I really like them. I feel like I'm gonna be losing my follow me driver pretty soon. Get a little too far ahead of him. So you can see in the ground we got all kinds of good nutrients in here. Tilled in a lot of good residue. Probably end the video here, and hopefully we can get some videos of planting up soon. So thanks for watching.